is one of those difficult Markian texts that tempt many a pastor to just skip right over, myself included. At first glance, it appears all law and order, but little grace. Historically, scholars have written off the Gospel of Mark as overly simplistic, rudimentary in its style compared to the other Gospels. And perhaps this is so because it was written for a predominantly lower socioeconomic class. However, recently, theologians are beginning to understand the brilliance of Mark's authorship and the sophisticated theology that is revealed upon deeper reading. Today's text is a prime example of the depth of Mark's writing. The Pharisees approach Jesus to test him. There is no other intent. They know the law of Moses, and they know that within the Jewish scriptures, there are contradictions difficult to reconcile. They engage Jesus in this particular question, not simply to test his knowledge, but to trip him up by drawing a boundary. They know John the Baptist spoke truth to the issue of divorce to King Herod Antipas, and it didn't end well for him. Jesus expertly navigates the beginning of this encounter with a question that both acknowledges the rabbinic tradition and foundational thinking behind the question, while lobbing the proverbial ball back into their court to see which Jewish scriptural text they will cite. The Pharisees choose Deuteronomy 24. Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her, which acknowledges the reality of divorce in Torah. However, they fail to acknowledge any other text in their scriptural canon, such as Malachi 3:16, which states, "For I hate divorce, says the Lord, the God of Israel, and covering one's garment with violence, says the Lord of hosts. So take heed to yourselves, and do not be faithless." This text, which is also part of the Jewish tradition, speaks to the spirit of the Torah, yet would be contradictory to what the Pharisees just claimed. Legalism does not easily hold paradox. However, Jesus uniquely possesses that capacity in his scholarship, and in a final lob across the net of this debate, goes back to the very beginning, Berit in Hebrew, or the book of Genesis, as we know it. He does not deny the validity of the Deuteronomic text, but interprets the spirit of the law by reading it intertextually with Genesis 1:27, 2:24, and 5:2. He responds, "But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his mother and father and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." Jesus offers a precedent to the Pharisees' legal argument that they themselves have overlooked, noting that the law of Moses was only necessary because of our human brokenness. "For in the beginning, God created us for unity, in order that we might be faithful, loving custodians of one another and of all of God's creation." To be clear, the Pharisees are not concerned with issues of human sexuality. Though that was often debated by different sects within the rabbinic tradition, that is not the case here. This test of Jesus, this drawing of a boundary, takes issue with Jesus' disruption of the economic status quo. Men could justify divorcing their partners and remarrying for a second bridal wealth payment. These bridal wealth payments shaped marriage into an economic transition, albeit one that only benefited males. This unjust cultural practice exploited women, put their economic security, their very livelihood, at risk. Other reasons for justifying divorce could be claimed, but divorce certificates were drawn up by men. Women had no other economic recourse than marriage, and if divorced, they faced abject poverty. Jesus justice to this unjust humanitarian issue of his time by going to the very core of not who, but how God created us to be. One of the first things you quickly learn in seminary is to avoid saying, "The Bible clearly says," for both the Hebrew and Christian scriptures are full of paradox and contradiction, and for good reason. God reveals God's self in paradox. This is what our Christian doctrine proclaims. Yet, like the Pharisees, we often like to cherry-pick scripture for self-justification of our own thinking and practices. Texts such as this one in Mark's Gospel are often used to draw boundaries. Boundaries that force women to stay in unhealthy and abusive marriages, or create divisions that drive the LGBTQ+ community out of Christian community. Theologian Luis Menendez Atuna reminds us that this text could be considered a text of terror, a phrase coined by the renowned scholar Phyllis Tickle in the 1970s to describe difficult scriptural passages such as this, often ones that have been used to inflict pain on marginalized communities. Cherry-picking a text such as this, or any scriptural verse, to justify uncompassionate and inhumane practices misunderstands Jesus' message, and it glosses over the profundity of Mark's writing. The Apostle Paul's letter to the Galatians, which also cites Genesis 1:27, as Jesus does today, perhaps offers us a helpful intertextual reading to grow in our understanding of Mark's gospel. Paul writes to the struggling and exploited Galatians, "There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's descendants, heirs according to the promise." Paul grasps the radical good news emerging in Mark's gospel, connects it to his own Jewish tradition, and expands on its theology. For in the beginning, God created us for unity, and in our division, God rebirths us into new identities through Jesus Christ as one in him. The Pharisees' legalistic argument seeks to uphold the status quo by law, even in the absence of humane social practice, a practice that denies God's love for neighbor. Later in the house with the disciples, when they ask Jesus again about the matter, he elaborates this point. He states, "Whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery." This is a curious statement. For while divorce was not uncommon in antiquity, it was inconceivable, paradoxical, that a woman would ever divorce from her union to face dire consequences. Therefore, it is with irony that Jesus reminds the disciple, "If held to the letter of the law in mutuality, we all fall short of achieving his purpose," while simultaneously redirecting their attention to those victimized by the present injustice. Lutheran theology reveals our own internal paradox. We are both sinner and saint. And it is into the fulcrum of this paradox that Jesus enters, pointing us back to God's love and loving intent for our lives. The spirit of the law is that we might live in unity with and for one another. The law itself acknowledges the internal paradox of our own fractured state. And it is into these divisions Jesus Christ enters and offers grace. God created us for unity, yet in our broken state, we are made for grace. Jesus confronts the legalistic boundaries humans lay to create division and inflict pain and offers us grace. path of living grace through him towards its fullest expression of the unity God intended. It is grace we receive in abundance through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ when we ourselves are unable to love one another as we ought. And this is why we may need to delve more deeply into these difficult and uncomfortable texts, despite our desire to skip over them. For we can never hear too much about the abundant grace we receive daily through our Lord.